Yes. Say cheese.
Not beer. Hot stove. He's got to wear his hat. He doesn't feel good with those hats.
No, because they put it on my hat or with my shoes.
Well, we'll get started here. Rick, we will end at quarter two, so we're not getting behind. Realize that, you know, people need to eat. I'm Glen Gillis from the University of Saskatchewan and my cohort from Florida Atlantic University. We've been collaborating for 20 plus years. I think our first collaboration was the NASA biennial that was in 2000. So it's been 20 years now. And so we've been collaborating back in those days. That was a couple years that we were at the same institution. So from afar, we've been still collaborating and also composing, and gets a little tricky with that distance in between. And we usually get together at conferences more than anything else. So we'll talk a little bit about the pieces, but our first piece that we're going to do is called Walkabout. I'll let Jamie talk about that because he was the one that decided on the title. We do a lot of sessions, or when we do get together, a lot of what we do is just play. Now, what's interesting about the didgeridoo, the non-traditional instrument as opposed to the so-called traditional saxophone, is still considered traditional. They seem to be instruments that are so much alike, and not just in appearance and other ways, but acoustically. So the didgeridoo, of course, will be down in the cellar, where I will be more up on top, and there's a lot of empty space in between. So
yeah, the conventional wisdom for composers is not to voice instruments really far apart. You know, that you wouldn't have a really high instrument and a low instrument voice together. And he plays way up in his register, as you guys probably know. However, the didgeridoo, although it has a low fundamental, it has a very rich spectrum of harmonics that actually go up pretty high into the frequency range. So by having him so high and having me so low, it actually allows space for me to manipulate the timbre and the harmonics of the didgeridoo. We didn't understand how that worked for about 18 years or so. We knew it did work sonically, but we never really figured out how it worked acoustically. We just knew it did. So this is a piece called Walkabout. It's one of our newest compositions. I think it is our newest composition, actually. And a walkabout is a term that the Aborigines in Australia use to describe a sort of a, for someone to say, I'm going to go on a walkabout. And what it means is that they're just going to go and walk somewhere and see what happens. We're going to walk about.
That's pretty much what happens with us. We just
Just walk about. One is going to be fairly, we use a lot of effects, but this one's going to be pretty dry. I have a little bit of boost just because I can't compete with the volume of the saxophone. And this is more of a traditional Aboriginal piece where the didgeridoo plays pretty much a strict rhythmic pattern. The clap sticks that would be played by the songman, and then it would be to accompany a singer. So he's the singer, and I'm the didgeridoo in a more, probably our most traditional sense. And we're just going to use the natural acoustics of the room here for this.
several times, and it's called Canis Lupus, which means gray wolf. And it could be a programmatic piece, in a sense. Basically, we're two wolves caught in Lethbridge snowstorm. No, well, I guess we could think more further north, but in the wilderness. And we're howling back and forth, and we're trying to find each other in the storm. So, and of course, the way that the last chord works out, guess what? They find each other, so. And he's going to put on a traditional.
And this has a little bit of, he's going to be dry. But I'm gonna be have a little bit of flavor here in terms of reverberation. We'll talk more about that later. Spaces where they capture the acoustics of a room, and then we can reproduce it in real time. So the difference between that
snow.
using these captured reverberations. And there's a pretty huge library of convolution reverbs. Places like the Taj Mahal, the Sydney Opera House, the King's Chamber at the Great Pyramid of Giza, for example. And this reverb also allows one to make their own acoustic, capture their own acoustics. So I've done some, we've done some in England, I did some in Croatia this summer. I've done his man cave at his house in Saskatoon.
Garage.
And I have a really cool stairwell at my university in South Florida that I've also captured. So it gives us a lot of choice, and it's almost like the environment that you play in becomes another instrument. So it's a matter of really being sensitive to those acoustics and seeing how that affects the overall piece is where we're coming from.
Right.
What are we doing next?
You wanted to do fanfare.
Oh,
originally,
fanfare.
Fanfare you do at the beginning, but we decided.
Okay. So.
It's a short 3-minute piece.
Yeah, usually this is a fanfare, so usually we play at the beginning. But we're kind of going from the complex to the more mundane, I guess, if you will. From the dry to the more wet. So this is one that has a backing track. This is what the backing track sounds like.
Which is more didgeridoos if you can do that.
Yeah, this is something that was recorded in the same space that I used for the previous example. The acoustics of that space will be able to be captured. Give me a two, make sure that you're up. Okay. And
you just said a two.
A two.
Want a longer two?
That's good. That's good. And
so the acoustical space that he was talking about is that's where you recorded 20 years ago?
Yeah, 1997. Recorded an album in this underground water cistern in Fort Warden, Washington. And it's a magical acoustic space. It was kind of my inspiration for exploring acoustics. Of course, it's really hard to take this, 5 million gallon, whatever it was, water cistern around the globe with you. So when I found that I could use the acoustics of that space in a live situation, I was pretty excited about it. For this one, I'm going to use what I call a slide didgeridoo. This is the Arnold Palmer model. Originally, these tubes were used in a golf bag to separate the clubs. They don't really use them much anymore because golf bags have built-in separators now.
They're obsolete.
Yes, it's obsolete. Actually, I'm going to change my mind. I'm not going to use that. I'm going to play in the silo from my home university. So this is like I was, if I'd be home, there was a stairwell right across in the building next to where my office is. And we will go there, and I'll take my didgeridoo classes. Yes, I do teach a didgeridoo class. And we'll take the class in there and play it. So it's a three-story concrete circular stairwell. I call it the silo. And that's the one that I'm using. And Glen is in, I believe he is in the Mozart Hall in Vienna, Austria. I'll double check here. Yes, Mozart Hall. The concert house in Vienna. So I'm in Boca Raton, Florida, and he's in Vienna.
And we have a backing track.
And we have a backing track. It's in Washington State.
Here we go, three different places.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Can you check?
Ready?
Thank you.
this idea, I was actually in St. Louis, Missouri, it was August 17th, 2016, and experienced it. It was actually maybe not totally eclipse, but it was like 99.some% total eclipse. Couldn't really tell the difference. I didn't know why. What was interesting is that when you have a complete eclipse, actually, I should call back up a little bit. When it was like almost there, it was just a little bit hazy looking. It wasn't dark, but it was. It happened almost like you took a dimmer and went, ooh, went like that. It was that quick. Went from that you could see fine, and then all of a sudden, in a period of 5 seconds, the lights, the outside lights of the like the automatic lights come on the city lights, and the cicadas. In that area, there's those noisy insects that come out at night. They all of a sudden came out. And then within seconds, we were standing on a lawn, and the grass got wet. That was the weird thing. It was like, this is kind of surreal. And the eclipse went on just about 2 minutes and 15-20 seconds, that kind of thing. And so that was kind of an interesting experience. And especially when you have to wear special glasses, which were, by the way, really hard to find. We ended up going to see a presentation at, they call it UMSL, University of Missouri, St. Louis. And, and the reason why we went was so we could get glasses, because there was a presentation about talking about the eclipse. But it was really interesting watching the complete eclipse and then the corona, or what they call it, the diamond light. So it was just, so that resonated with me. So I suggested to Jamie we should do a piece. And of course, you captured the video from Oregon. That was the complete eclipse.
I stole it from YouTube. But it's the video's processed. And
so I guess I have to also run this too. So we have to sort of coordinate two things at once here. Wait at my computer.
it's a rhythmic piece. Any other? Well, if you guys have any questions or anything, oh, there's a hand back there.
You guys mentioned the using the acoustics of a room as a part of the compositional process. I was just wondering how the distance between two of you, one of you being in Florida and the other in Saskatchewan, how does that affect the compositional process?
Well, it's an artificial environment that we're creating, even though it is, you know, it's a digital reverberation. And of course, this room itself has its own acoustics. So it's always kind of a mitigation. This kind of stuff actually works best outside, where you don't have any reflected sound, and you can just use sound reinforcement, a PA system, to basically create the entire acoustic spectrum. But when we're in any space, let's say I'm playing from the silo in Boca Raton, I'm bringing it in here, but I'm also introducing it into this space as well. And that's kind of why we like to do some of the dry stuff, where a couple of pieces we did were just using the acoustics of the space. So we have a lot of flexibility, and you have to kind of just judge how things are going to work. Some rooms are deader than others, and some rooms are lighter than others. You just kind of work with it. It's about being really sensitive to the space that you're playing in, like it's another musical instrument, basically. Well, if you guys have any more questions or comments, we'd be happy to talk to you afterwards. And thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
This is...